My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made this religion one which is comprehensive, one in which we will find guidance for every single issue that we have, whether it be pertaining to this worldly life or to the akhirah. But from the tricks and traps of shaitan is that he will come to every single one of us and he will say to us that because you're a practicing Muslim, because you're a Muslim who abides by the laws and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you're not able to enjoy the beauty, you're not able to benefit from the luxuries of this worldly life. But when you look at the Quran and you look at the Sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is completely the opposite. It is completely far from this claim, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created this dunya, this worldly life for us. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a number of ahadith, highlighted how the Muslim is the one who indulges themselves within this worldly life in order to benefit themselves for the akhirah. Because when you look at those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited, that which He has made haram, every single prohibition, there is some benefit for the Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to protect, wishes to uplift some sort of harm that will befall us, hence the prohibition from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith that is collected within the Jami' of Imam Tirmidhi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من الكبر. That the one, they will not enter into paradise, the one whom they have an atom's weight of arrogance within their hearts. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting with his companions, and a young companion, he got up and he said, O Messenger of Allah, verily one of us, we like to have good clothing and we like to have good shoes, we like to wear good footwear. Because this companion, he thought kibr, arrogance, pride, it was in presenting yourself as looking good. He thought that arrogance was when you wear good clothing or when you have nice shoes. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he clarified and he said, Inna Allah jameel, yuhibbul jamal. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful and He loves that which is beautiful. He loves beauty. Verily this is not what arrogance is, but arrogance is when you leave the truth, you reject the truth, and you look down upon the rest of creation, you look down upon other people. You're haughty and you're arrogant. This is what pride is. As our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he clarified and he explained. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he blesses you with his blessings, then Allah, he wants to see that upon you. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said in another hadith, that which is collected again within the Jami' of Imam Tirmidhi, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he loves to see his slaves with those blessings that he has gifted them with. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you wealth, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wants to see that wealth apparent upon you. It's not from righteousness that if you have wealth that you're always presenting yourself in front of people in a scruffy manner, or that if you have hair that it's always disheveled and it's always scruffy, because this is not from righteousness. Because when you apply the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within your life, and they're apparent within your life, then that is a way of you being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a way of you showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those blessings. And in return, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love, it descends upon you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He gifts us with His blessings, Allah wants to see those blessings upon us. Not that we're haughty, not that we're arrogant, but rather in a manner, in a way that we're grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those blessings. In another hadith, that which is collected within the Sahih of Ibn Hibban, upon the authority of the illustrious companion Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas radiyallahu ta'ala an, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Arba'un min as-sa'ada. Four things are from happiness. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he listed them. Al-mar'atu as-saliha, wal-maskan al-wasi' wal-jaru as-salih, wal-markab hani'a, wa arba'un min as-shaqaya. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that four things, they're from happiness: a righteous spouse, and a dwelling, a house that is spacious, and a neighbor that is good, they're good towards you, and a mode of transportation that is reliable to you. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, four things are from the causes of sadness, they're the causes of worry and stress for a person, and he mentioned the opposite. Al-mar'atu as-su, wal-maskanu ad-diq, wal-jaru as-su, wal-markab as-su. The evil spouse, the house or the dwelling that's restricted, the bad and evil neighbor, and the unreliable mode of transportation. If you look at this hadith of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, all of these things, these four things, eight in total, four good, four bad, they are from the affairs of this worldly life, the affairs of the dunya. That a person, their cause of happiness and their cause of sadness, part of it is as a result of these four things. A righteous spouse, someone who is always there to help you, someone who's always there to support you, someone who's always there to comfort you. And the opposite is true. Someone who doesn't respect you, a spouse that's always bad to you. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned a spacious dwelling, a house that's spacious, it's not restricted, it's not tight, it's easy for you and your family to reside within that house, within that dwelling. And likewise, a cause of sadness, a cause of stress is when that dwelling is restricted. That dwelling is restricted and it's difficult for you and your family to reside and to live in that dwelling. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, "Jaru salih aw jaru su," the good neighbor or the evil neighbor. The good neighbor who's always there looking out for you, who's always helpful to you. When you see them in the morning, they're always smiling to you. This is a cause of happiness. And at the same time, a cause of sadness or a cause of worry and stress is that evil neighbor whom you're always afraid of their actions because of the harm and the evil that they bring to you and your family, the harm and the evil that they bring to your household. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the last item he mentioned or the last thing he mentioned as being a cause of happiness or a sadness is a mode of transportation that is either good or bad. A mode of transportation that's reliable. It doesn't give up on you. It's always there. Whenever you need it, you're able to ride upon it and it's always there to get you from A to Z. And at the same time, a cause of sadness or a cause of stress is when that mode of transportation, there's no barakah within it, it's unreliable, it doesn't assist you in the state of emergencies. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said. These are just a few ahadith, and there are a number of ahadith, many more, that we can look at. But the point being is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he wanted us to indulge within this worldly life for the benefit of the akhirah. For the benefit of the akhirah. And this is why when you look at the supplications of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they are comprehensive. He wouldn't just supplicate for this worldly life, but rather the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would supplicate for the life of this dunya and the akhirah as well. From the most common supplications of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was that he would supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Allahumma ighfir li dhanbi wa wassi' li fi dari wa barik li fi ma razaqtani." Oh Allah, forgive my sins and enlarge or make spacious my dwelling and bless me in the provision that you've provided me with. Allahumma ighfir li dhanbi. Oh Allah, forgive my sins. These are from the affairs of this religion, of the affairs of the akhirah. وَوَسِّعْ لِي فِي دَارِي and make spacious and enlarge in my dwelling. This is from the affairs of the dunya, this worldly life. وَبَارِكْ لِي فِي مَا رَزَقْتَنِي and bless me in the provision that you have given me, O Allah. The income that I receive, the salary that I have, O Allah, bless that for me. This is again from the affairs of the dunya. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would be comprehensive in his supplication. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would enter the masjid, he would have a supplication. When he would leave the masjid, he would make another supplication. When he would enter the masjid, he would say, "Allahumma iftahli abwaab rahmatik." Oh Allah, open for me the doors of your mercy. This is from the affairs of the akhirah, of this religion, of the hereafter. Asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his mercy when you take a step into the masjid. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would leave the masjid, he would supplicate to Allah, "Allahumma inni as'aluka min fadlik." Oh Allah, I seek your bounty. I seek your grace. I seek your virtue. This is from the affairs of the dunya, the affairs of this worldly life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the Quran, he states, "Wabtaghi fima ataka Allahu ad-dar al-akhirah." And take from that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, so to achieve that which you want to achieve for the hereafter, meaning to strive for the hereafter. That which Allah has given you, take that of this worldly life for your hereafter. The scholars of tafsir, they had two main interpretations for this verse of the Quran. The first of those is that the first group of scholars of tafsir, they said what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he means by this verse is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he wants us to use the time that we have within this worldly life to worship him and to use that worship, to use that time in order to increase our ranks in Jannah, in paradise for our hereafter. And the second group of scholars, they said, no. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants from us is that Allah, what He's blessed us with within this dunya, within this worldly life, Allah wants us to benefit from those beauties and those luxuries, but we don't become too indulged within them. Rather, we strike a balance and we enjoy those things and we seek our akhirah using those means, using that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided us with. And a third group of scholars, they came and they combined between both of those opinions and they said, we use the time that we have within this worldly life to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we don't neglect the dunya and indulging within the dunya, because thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا, and do not forget your portion of this worldly life. Don't forget your portion of this worldly life. And hence, when you look at the sharia, you look at the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find that the underlying principle, the asl within this sharia, within this religion, is that every single thing is halal unless proven otherwise. If you look at food and drink, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has made everything halal with the exception of a few things, that which He has prohibited within the Quran and that which our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has prohibited within his sunnah. Likewise, when it comes to transaction, business dealings, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, within his ahadith, within his sunnah, he spoke about greatly in depth about business transactions and dealings. Every type of transaction is halal unless proven otherwise, unless there is a specific text to prove that it's haram. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states within the Quran, وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعُ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made permissible business transactions. He's made permissible business and He has prohibited usury. This is the underlying principle. بارك الله لنا ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعنا بما فيه من الآيات والذكر الحكيم. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. استغفر الله. اللهم صل وسلم على الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيد خلق الله أجمعين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن صار على سبيله ونهجه واستنى بسنته واهتدى بهده إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would encourage his companions to indulge within this worldly life in order to benefit themselves for the akhirah, in order to benefit themselves for the akhirah as well, to show that the Muslim is the one who they not only think about themselves, but they're ready to benefit the society as well with the skills and the knowledge that they have. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would encourage his companions to work, and he would encourage them to specialize in the various fields that they were good at. And this is why when you look at the lives of the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, they were people who not only were scholars of this religion, but they were people who would indulge and they would excel within their speciality, within those fields that they were good at. Abdurrahman ibn Awf radiallahu ta'ala an was from amongst the 10 companions who was promised Jannah, he was promised paradise. When he passed away, he left behind a huge amount of wealth as inheritance. And he left behind 16 million dirham for his wives. And he had four wives, so each wife received 4 million dirham. The scholars of inheritance, when they analyzed this, they said the wife in Islam, the spouse, they are to receive an eighth share, an eighth of the wealth. And so as a result, when they calculated how much wealth in totality he left behind, it was about 120 million dirham. In today's time, it's equivalent to billions of pounds. This was a companion, not any companion, but a companion who was promised Jannah whilst walking upon the face of this earth. Yes, he was extremely affluent and he was extremely successful within the field of business. He was extremely successful when it would come to business dealings and transactions. Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas radiallahu ta'ala an, another from the 10 companions who were promised Jannah, upon his deathbed, he wanted to give all of his wealth in charity, because he knew that which was coming in front of him was the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so as a result, he wanted to give all of that wealth and make it as a means of charity for him, so that it can be a source of good deeds for him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he entered upon him and he said, no, O Sa'ad, don't give all of your wealth in charity. So then Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas, he said, O Messenger of Allah, I want to give a half of my wealth in charity. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, no, give something less. And so Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, eventually he said, I want to give a third of my wealth in charity. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he agreed to this and he said, وَالثُّلُثُ وَالثُّلُثُ كَثِيرٌ. A third, and a third is enough, and a third is sufficient. A third is sufficient. Why? Because then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, it's better to leave your heirs, your children, with some sort of wealth that they can live upon, rather than for them having to go and ask people for wealth, ask people for money. And this is an important act of worship as well. Just as giving charity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an important act of worship, leaving your heirs behind with some sort of wealth is an extremely important act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. Why? Because this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised us. Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, and I'm going to end with this example inshallah ta'ala, when he came to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as you all know, he paired the companions of Mecca, the Muhajireen, with the companions of Medina, the Ansar. And so one companion from Mecca was paired with one companion of Medina. Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, what he would do with his brother from the Ansari companions, he would say to him, one day I will work, and on that day you will go and you will study with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and you will learn the religion. And on the night when you come back, and I come back after working, and you come back after learning, you will teach me that which you learned, and I will share my wealth with you. And on the following day, I will go and I will sit with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to learn this religion, whilst you go out to work. And at the end of the day, when night would approach, I will return, you will return, and you will share your wealth with me, and I will share the knowledge that I learnt from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam with you. This is how the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, they would facilitate within their lives. This is how they would work within their lives. And so my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it doesn't prevent you, the Sharia doesn't prevent you from excelling within your careers. It doesn't prevent you from attaining a high position. Rather, Islam, it wants you to excel within your careers. Islam, it wants you to do good within the place of work. Islam wants you to do well within this, within your life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you were to look at his Sharia, if you were to look at the rulings of Islam, what prevents you from opening up a business here on Ealing Road, just next to the masjid? What prevents you from running that business 24/7? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it permissible for you to run that business 24/7, with the exception of an hour within the week, and that is for Salatul Jumu'ah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited trade during that hour, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he states, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. O you who believe, when the call of Jumu'ah is made, then hasten to the prayer and leave off buying and selling, leave off your work, and hasten to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is most better for you if that which you knew. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he states, فَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةُ فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. And when the prayer, it's finished, you fulfill this obligation, then disperse across the earth and seek the bounty of Allah. Work and earn a halal income for yourself and your family. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wants from us. But when we do this, we must bear two things in mind. When we work and we strive within our careers and we excel within our careers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wants two things from us. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wants us to do things with excellence. Inna Allaha kataba al-ihsana ala kulli shay. Allah, he wants excellence in every single thing that you do. When you worship Allah, when you offer the Jum'ah prayer, do it with excellence. Whatever job that you have, if you're a solicitor, if you're a barrister, if you're an accountant within an accounting firm, do your job with excellence. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number two, he doesn't want you to cheat. He doesn't want you to lie. He doesn't want you to do haram within that job. Rather, Allah wants you to earn a halal income for yourself and your family. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he blesses our income, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he blesses our rizq, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he blesses our families, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he preserves us and our families from the tricks and traps of shaitan. ثم صلوا رحمكم الله على الخير البرية وأزكى البشرية صاحب الحوض والشفاء فقد أمركم بدأ فيه بنفسه وثنى بملائكة مسبحة بقدسه وأيها بكم أيها المؤمنون بالجن والإنس فقال قولا كريما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن الأربعة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين الذين قضوا بالحق وبه كانوا يعدلون أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وأنصار أصحاب النبي كمحمد أجمعين وأن التابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وأن معهم بجودك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين المسلمين اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين واذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر اعداءك اعداء الدين يا رب العالمين اللهم انصر المسلمين والمستضعفين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين اللهم ارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين واشف مرضانا مرضى المسلمين برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأولى وأجل وأتم وأهم وأعظم وأكبر وأقم الصلاة.